First, I want to thank Covington and Burling for giving us this phenomenal venue, which is truly spectacular, and for arranging for the thunderstorm to be over by the time we begin this program. Maybe that's really the result of the ticket card. And that it's going to be a clear day going forward. But it's, and I thank you all for coming. It's a big crowd for a summer's afternoon. In fact, a Thursday afternoon, many of you I know heading to the beach from here. If I went over all of Kurt's accomplishments and books and various other things he's done over these years, we wouldn't have time for the program. So you've got his bio, so I will skip it. But I would note one thing, which is the first time in my 11 years as president of the National Committee that all three of my children are here for this program. All three of my daughters are here for this program, and that has never happened before. So you must be a big deal, Kurt. You are one very big deal.
Are you?
No, I do these all the time. This is really unusual. But this book, now, you'll notice that my copy, the cover, is torn. It's torn because it's so well worn already. It wasn't torn in frustration. It's truly an extraordinary book. I recall, 45 years ago, taking a course from James B. Thompson, who was a professor at Harvard on U.S.-China relations. And in this course, he was a former assistant national security advisor under the Johnson administration. And if he were to give that course today, or if this course would be given today, this book would be the textbook for it. Because it not only lays the intellectual foundation for U.S.-Asia relations, it gives you specific ideas about how we should implement the pivot. So it lays the foundation and says, and we should do this. It's not like he's operating at 30 or 60,000 feet. He's down there in the weeds. We may not agree with every suggestion that he has, but you have to absolutely admire the depth of the book and the clarity of what he's writing. And this is a perfect follow-on to the one part of this bio, which we should mention, which is from 2009 to 2013. He was the Assistant Secretary of State for East Asian and Pacific Affairs when President Obama and Secretary Clinton announced the pivot. So this book, in many ways, and one thing I wish about the book is it came out in 2009, laying the foundation then, because it would have been actually better. So rather than have Kurt talk, we're just going to make this a Q&A. So let me start with the first question, if I may. And it's, why this book, and why now?
First of all, thank you so much. Grateful to be with my good friend, who probably has done more to advance American understanding of China and our critical relationship in Asia than almost anyone else. I've been with him on numerous occasions as he's brought Americans, many of whom knew very little about Asia, to China for engagements, and I've been the beneficiary of some of those. Very productive meetings. Also, I'm joined by a variety of people with remarkable service, much deeper than my own. Grateful to colleagues from the State Department, Desai, and Nick. Also, one of my former bosses at the Treasury Department is also here. Schaefer, great that all of you have turned out, and I'll try to make this as interesting as possible. Any of you who know anything about both government writing a book, understand how difficult it is. And so what normally happens is you build up all these frustrations in government. You just think, I can't wait to write about this later, and God, am I going to fix your wagon, and stuff like that. And then you get out, and then you write 200 pages quickly, and then you set it aside for a couple of weeks, and you look at it, and then you just think to yourself, this is really crap. It's really bad. And then you realize it's going to take you much longer to write the kind of book that you want to write. So I set out to try to write a book that explains why I think that the United States is on such a substantial detour in the 21st century. And that, without question, the lion's share of the history of this century is going to be written in Asia. But if you looked at the conduct of our foreign policy and national security over the last 15 years, you certainly wouldn't know it. And that every institution inside the U.S. government, in business, in education, in nonprofits, has not invested enough in becoming an Asian century. So that is the primary rationale for the book. I tried to write a book that would be illuminating, it has some historical context. Too many people that approach problems don't really understand as much about what has come before, recognizing that this historical tapestry, particularly in Asia, with all its complexities and disappointments and mistakes driven by inexperience or lack of knowledge. And I also wanted to write a book that were, you know, parts are funny. I mean, people think about diplomacy as being really the, kind of the, from the ramparts and, you know, exciting and dramatic, and they just don't realize how much of it is absurd. And so at the very highest moment of my professional career, I was involved in what I thought was a quite funny anecdote, which I can talk about a little bit later, which I saved for the end of the book, which is meant to give sort of a human feel to.
That was going to be one of my questions. Right. Can I ask about that anecdote about Will and Undercut Sales?
No,
because we're selling the book tonight. It's for sale, and Kurt, you get Kurt's autograph with it.
And I would also say, I also wanted to write a book that was that was animated by good spirits. So I you know, you look at people who leave government, they settle scores and stuff. The only person that has criticized and made fun of this book is me. And I try to take responsibility for areas where I think the effort was lacking and try to be gracious among all the people that I work with. I titled it The Pivot almost as a joke because the word got such criticism at the outset and was so fundamentally and thoroughly misunderstood. And the rollout for the concept was so poorly implemented. And I would say I'm largely responsible for that. So I tried to explain why the concept was chosen, how it was misunderstood. And in many respects, I think Rebalance actually is a more careful and probably easier to understand concept. We settled on the term pivot with the idea of a basketball player concept being able to move effortlessly from side to side, not in any way relinquishing important responsibilities in other visual contexts. But I think that visual was completely lost with the idea of a pivot, of someone turning completely away from critical American responsibilities in places like the Middle East and Europe. And I tried to underscore in the book the real serious problems of misunderstanding that were underscored in the selling of this concept, and that everything that the United States has ever done of consequence and significance in the last 40 years, we've done with Europe. And one of the things I tried to lay out in the book is that we need a much more consequential discussion with Europe about Asia going forward.
Because it's so much in the news, we should probably start with the arbitration decision on the Philippine case filed against China, and how that kind of interacts with the pivot.
Yeah, thank you for that. So, look, all of you have followed this judgment that comes out of The Hague and the law of the sea. I would say that the ruling of the court, the three judges, 2 days ago was somewhat of a surprise to everyone. If you look at previous judgments, they tend to be a little bit like Supreme Court, you know, a little bit here, a little bit there. There's something that can be found to legitimize various perspectives. This was a resounding ruling that in many ways undermines and invalidates every aspect of the so-called nine-dash line and has created concerns, obviously, in China, but also in Taiwan somewhat as well. I think I think Chinese friends and interlocutors were surprised at the depth and the expansiveness of the ruling. I wouldn't be all surprised if they're doing some reflection now, Steve, as we speak. My own view is that this will give Chinese friends an opportunity, not immediately, but over time, to rethink carefully. Virtually every great power that has faced rulings like this, including the United States, over time has found a way to understand and accommodate understanding of complex rulings that go against them. I think there are some that believe that this will lead to China taking dramatic and draconian steps in the South China Sea and Asia. I do not believe they will do so in the short term. I do not think that that is in their best strategic interests, and I think they know it. There was a lot of talk before, Steve knows this very well, that 60 nations would come out supporting the Chinese interpretation of this ruling was inviolate from the start, rebalanced from the start, and I don't think we've seen anything like that. There has been a lot of fury, a lot of condemnation from Beijing, but I think at the same time, quietly, they recognize that this is a substantial setback. And I think it has caused others to reflect that there is a value in this process. I think for Americans, we have to recognize there is an irony. We are not signatories to the law of the sea, and we are insisting that China follow to the letter of the law of the rule. China is a signatory, but doesn't want to follow, right, a binding decision. I will tell you also, fascinatingly, we've had a number of occasions, Steve, in the last 4 years since the actual signing of the law of the sea, where we've tried to get the 67 votes necessary for passage. I've been involved in two of the last most recent. Ironically, in testimony in front of the Senate, just conservative senators, I won't name names, several years ago, actually expressed their reasons for not signing on to the treaty in precisely the term that Chinese friends used here, saying that we do not want to allow an international court to infringe potentially on the sovereignty of the United States. I think a judgment and a view that would have been reflected in Beijing this week. Ultimately, this is the long game here, and so there will not be any immediate judgments. I think oftentimes people are looking for specific steps that can be taken immediately. 2 years ago, when the Philippines were encouraged to go to the International Court of Arbitration, people said this is a feckless effort. I don't think people think that now. This is a useful and valuable effort that I think validates international law. But it is part of a wide-ranging American strategy that involves high-level, respectful dialogue with Chinese interlocutors, engagement with allies, building partnerships with other countries in the region, like Vietnam and the Philippines, using international law, working within the context of international organizations, trying to establish global norms and values around these issues. And see that the heart of this, fundamentally, is something I argue in the book, that essentially what we and other countries have managed to do over the last 40 years is create an operating system of sorts. And I know operating system connotes a computer, but in fact, this operating system is a human substance. It involves peaceful resolution of disputes, the sanctity of trade and agreements, the ability to have an understanding of freedom of navigation, freedom of the seas. So it is a complex web of generally shared perspectives that have led to the 40 best years in the history of the planet, remarkable achievements of trade and commerce and exchange, and probably the countries that have gained the most from it, the United States undoubtedly is a valued beneficiary, but China has probably gained the most from this system. of any other state. And I think right now there are voices in China that are suggesting that there are aspects of this system that somehow are involved in containment, a concept that I would argue is completely and utterly irrelevant to the circumstances of Asia today. No country in Asia would accept the dictatorship. Every country in Asia wants a better relationship with China, including the United States. And that ultimately what we are about is trying to secure this 21st century operating system that will have to be adapted and adopted broadly and will have to adjust to suggestions and the needs of China. But what we do not want is to move back to a more 19th century spheres of influence sort of approach to Asia, which I believe some aspects of Chinese thinking around the South China Sea and other aspects in ASEAN suggest that that is the right approach for China. I do not believe that it's in the best strategic interests. And I think it is important that the United States and other countries make clear that this operating system has benefited the vast majority of nations and the world, and that it should be continued going forward.
Let's jump ahead before we then look at some of the intellectual foundations for the pivot, because you raised the bull of the sea and America's failure to ratify, the Senate's failure to ratify UNCLOS. And you talk about one of the risks to the pivot is kind of our political dysfunction today. Very late in the book, you say we may not be able to implement it because there's such dysfunction. One question actually relates to UNCLOS. Do you think that these events make it less or more likely that we'll see some progress in ratification?
And I appreciate Steve. It's so great to have someone who's actually read the book, because in fact, you know, you get condemned for stuff they didn't write or say. I really try at the end to be honest about all the challenges that the Rebalance or American Strategy in Asia will face. And I see around the room here a number of people who spend a lot of time in Asia. I will tell you, the biggest concerns in Asia right now really are not about China. They're not about North Korea. They're not about, you know, the lack of economic growth in Japan or the lack of fulfilling the promise of India. They're about the United States. Because the United States has played this remarkable role of providing strong engagement, support for allies, very optimistic engaged in commercial endeavors, a strong and durable defensive commitment. And I think fundamentally many of those issues aren't in play in this domestic environment in a way that they have not been for years. And so we will hopefully escape this electoral period, but the questions that have been raised will not be resolved quickly in November. And there is a hunch that there are fundamental changes afoot in the domestic political circumstances of the United States that will change the American engagement. Steve, remind me the exact question. I think I got off on it a little bit. What was it?
What's the effect going to be on the possibility of Senate ratification of UNCLOS?
So I would simply say, guys, that any vote currently, and those of you who don't live in Washington, of a treaty requires 67 votes in the Senate. To get 67 votes on anything right now is one of the most difficult things. We've gotten relatively close. We've never had a real, you know, vote on the law to see. We've gotten, you know, within probably 7 or 8 or 10 votes. But if you introduced, you know, a something to be voted on in the Senate that says we love our mothers, if mothers are good, you have people saying, I don't know about that. That seems pretty dicey to me. Define mothers, and exactly what you mean by that. There's a divisiveness, Steve, on Capitol Hill that I do not believe in the current environment gives us much hope about the law of the sea. The hope will be that this will animate it, but I think the concerns about sovereignty and the like are playing in the United States as well.
We stay again looking forward and talk about TPP. You define that as basically the fundamental economic part of the pivot. we now have two candidates that don't support the TPP. Obviously, it's already in front of the Senate. There's a possibility of a lame duck passage, or it sits in front of one of these two people as president. What's the outlook for TPP, and what does that mean for the pivot?
I would simply say I think it's going to be very difficult. The circumstances of the last couple of days have made it more so. I think what was necessarily that there's going to have to be some adjustments. That would be a challenging process. I think what's as important is what the political candidates have said, the presidential candidates, is what the key senators and congressmen have said. And most are suggesting that they have problems with the current text and that they don't, and I think quietly acknowledging that they may not have the votes. I think the larger problem is that, and again, this, you know, we sometimes talk about Asian policy as somehow disconnected from our domestic politics, but I think what has really happened fundamentally is that the foundational aspects of the support for trade for the last 30 years has been almost a rock solid Republican Party. I don't think that is the case any longer. Almost all indications are that, in fact, in much of the Republican Party, the current Republican Party, not the Republican Party in our minds, and sort of the Eisenhower Republican Party of, Oldsmobile Republican Party, but the current Republican Party, substantial reservations and concerns about trade. And I think, in fact, Representative Ryan understands that very clearly. So I think in the current environment, it's extremely difficult.
So we should not be expecting a lame duck passage.
I'll just stand on this.
Let's look back a little bit. I mean, one of the criticisms of the pivot when it came out was we weren't ignoring Asia at that point. In the book, you lay out a number of things which prior administrations did not do. So, whether it was Condi Rice skipping meetings or President W. Bush not going to meetings in Asia or various other things. But vis-a-vis China, you don't really mention much. Is there things that you would have done differently with China prior to 2009?
I would also say, just to be clear, so just on this question about whether we've done enough, I mentioned that at the outset of the administration, there was some back and forth that I thought was a little bit unfortunate, with some groups saying, look, we're back in Asia, and other groups saying that we've never left. And I would try to articulate that both those views, I believe, is incorrect. I think the fact is that for us to be, quote, unquote, back in Asia will require a succession of administrations. And I try to articulate clearly that the pivot or rebalance has only proceeded in fits and starts. There are certain things that have been done well, but not enough in other areas. And that we suffer from the same preoccupation on the Middle East, and some of the challenges that previous administrations have suffered from. So this is not meant in any way to be a partisan vote. At the same time, I think there is something to be said for the effectiveness of what President Obama's second prime minister tried to articulate. I think it's important to acknowledge that, but it's also built, Steve, on a bipartisan record that has enormous strengths. And I would argue that one of the great areas of strength is, in fact, China policy. I think China policy, despite all the challenges associated with the election period, has been a generally strong area of American foreign policy for almost 40 years. I do want to say, so the first idea that, that we're back in Asia, I think it's going to take much longer. But to those who responded that we never left in Asia, in fact, the price of admission to being effective in Asia has gone up dramatically, much more than 10 or 15 years ago. And it's just no longer possible to vote it in the way the United States has done at the strategic level. It's going to take much more to be effective. So I would argue that both are wrong, and the United States is going to have to step up its game very substantially to be effective going forward. On China policy per se, I think the larger argument in the book is that I think where the United States has got it right has been in the arena of consequential diplomacy between Beijing and Washington. But I would argue that that is no longer enough, and that bilateral, highly centralized sort of diplomacy between the two countries ignores other regional problems and, in fact, can create other difficulties. And so the idea is to embed our China policy more effectively in a larger Asian framework, which I think is going to be essential as we move forward.
The pivot made it into the Chinese response to the Philippine arbitral tribunal. Let me quote your very good friend, Cui Tiankai, Ambassador Cui said, when he was criticizing saying that the decision was null and void, he said, and I quote, "But tension started to rise about 5 or 6 years ago, about the same time we began to hear about pivoting to Asia. In the last few years, disputes intensified, relations strained, and confidence weakened." He's asserting that it was actually the pivot and the actions related to the pivot that caused the Chinese to react, whether it was in the East China Sea with the Diaoyudao Senkakus or the South China Sea, where they were forced to respond to increasing military actions by others in the region as well as us. So how do you respond to the Chinese? They constantly think the pivot is an attempt to contain.
Well, I tried to go through this, Steve, as you know, in the book. The first thing I have to say is, you know, probably my favorite. I don't want to hurt him, I don't want to cause any problems, but probably my favorite diplomat, the person I was closest to over the years, was Cui Tiankai. I found him to be an extraordinarily effective diplomat, a man of enormous credibility and just very able interlocutor. We worked through many problems together. I think it's a deniable case that in 2007, 2008, there's a heightened economic crisis, the global economic crisis. I think many Chinese strategic interlocutors began to take it on face value that the United States was in the midst of a hurdle of decline, and that the combination of the economic crisis and a rather profound preoccupation away from Asia, deep, sustained engagement in Afghanistan and Iraq, which Chinese interlocutors believed generally was sapping American power and strength, that their entire approach was something along the lines of what my daughters would say, "You go, girl, you're doing such important work, we'll handle Asia, but you continue on in this critical work in Afghanistan and Iraq." And I think there were those that believed that the United States was on the verge of literally vacating many of our strategic advantages built up over decades in Asia. And I believe that is fairly clearly understood. Initially, they looked at the Trans-Pacific Partnership, which did not include Japan. It took about 9% global trade, and they viewed it as Asia-specific trade as a not very effective contribution, and that compared to the trade initiative that China was putting out as really insignificant. And so we often would list the Chinese threats who would, you know, subtly suggest, "Is that the best you got? Right? Is that all you got?" I think if you look back over 40 years, there are a few things that are undeniable. And one is that the recurrent theme of American decline has animated the strategic conceptions of virtually every capital city, Japan, Singapore, and like. And almost all of them, at one time or another, have profoundly underestimated American power. At the end of the Second World War, Task Force Smith in the Korean War, which I described in the book, at the end of the Vietnam War, at the end of the Cold War, at the end of the global financial crisis, each led to profound concerns about whether the United States had the wit or the wisdom or the capability to sustain the edge of a global role. And one of the things that I've tried to underscore is that those who bet against the United States have lost a lot of money over 40 years. China bet heavily, I think, during this period, on the idea that the United States was going to be not a significant power going forward. And so, in many respects, I think the rebalance or pivot was actually underestimated by Chinese interlocutors when it was articulated. I think ultimately, the goal of that is to signal.
Now, for China, if I were Ambassador Tsui sitting here, I would say that is simply not true.
Yes.
That every Chinese action was a reaction to something that was done by somebody else. So you were integrally involved in the trying to get the, it was declassified, and courtesy of WikiLeaks, getting the Japanese to talk to the Chinese before the purchase of the Senkakus by the national government. You were trying to kind of get the Japanese to focus on the potential implications of this, and they responded, we got it covered, even though they didn't have it covered. The Chinese would argue, so you did the right thing, but the Chinese would argue, if Ambassador Tsui was sitting here, we just reacted. The Japanese broke a 40-year deal that we had, that we reached in 1972. With the Japanese, and they violated. So of course we had to respond. What choice did we have? And then out of frustration, because what can they really do? They're not going to fight a war over the Senkakus. They declare an ADIZ. And that was out of frustration. So how do you respond to kind of that?
Look, I think what Asia really, Stephen, is a good specific point, but what really Asia is about right now is it is adjusting in fits and starts and with many challenges to the dramatic rise of a country with a huge, massive military investments. I look back to the period when I was in the Pentagon in the 1990s and we speculated about what China would do in terms of building its military capability in 1995, 1996. In almost every case, they have far exceeded what even the most dramatic calculations were at that time. Invariably, when countries grow like this, they extend forward and they test barriers. So if you ask, or test parameters, so if you ask the Japanese or the Philippines or the Vietnamese or the Taiwans, they would say, look, it is not the truth that the status quo that for years there have been encroachments and movements against what has been an accepted status quo. And essentially, this sort of incremental approach was confronted by the Japanese and perhaps by others at the ASEAN Regional Forum meeting in Hanoi in 2010 as an attempt to say, look, this is these steps are antithetical to the maintenance of peace and stability. I understand the Chinese perspective on this, but I would simply say I also saw Steve on a dime. I mentioned the TPP. TPP went through being really an insignificant and not very powerful demonstration of American power with its enunciation. A year or two later is a vicious containment effort implemented by the United States. You just can't have both ways, right?
And so now it's evolved to, okay, we understand it, we understand.
I agree.
And we hope that we're going to be able to
join. And so that gets to really what, you look around the region, you have people in various countries say, look, we're on the verge of a major conflict between the United States and China. That fundamentally misunderstands the nature of our relationship. We are destined to work together. And it's going to be painful, it's going to be difficult, but it's also essential. And there are going to be elements of cooperation, but there are also going to be tensions in this relationship, and probably more tensions than in the past. And in fact, if there is not tension in the relationship, it probably means someone is not doing their job. But I would also say, if you look back over the last several years, it is easy to underestimate some of the achievements in the relationship. One of the most significant achievements that no one can point to, literally because of a variety of domestic issues in both countries, is the maintenance of peace and stability across the Taiwan Straits. It's profound, and it's clearly something to point to. Others have contributed to that. I think it's something that quietly there can be some confidence taken in that effort. Second, the United States and China, despite the view that the United States had in some respects mishandled the global economy in 2007, 2008, China played a substantial role in helping the global economy in a very difficult period. It is also the case that the role that China played behind the scenes on Iranian sanctions was very significant. And most recently, I mean, there will be those who say it doesn't exist. Climate change is an imagination, imaginary thing. The agreement reached between the United States and China, if implemented, will turn out to be one of the most significant achievements of modern times. And also, quietly, the dialogue that has emerged behind the scenes on North Korea, although inadequate, it's still not to the satisfaction of everyone, is important. And so it's critical to underscore the areas that we have achieved things, and we're in the midst of challenging bilateral investment treaty set of negotiations. This is a relationship that is going to have, we are learning to work together. And so when people say, well, look, we are proceeding down the road towards the Thucydian track, right, the rising power, I would simply point out the most recent example of that is how the Allied partners treated Germany before the First and Second World War, denying Germany their role, trying to keep them down. Nothing can be further from the truth with respect to China. The United States, leading the way, has insisted that China play and be included in the critical groupings, the WTO, the G20, working closely in East Asia Summit and the like. We expect and want China to take on a larger role. I think that the United States and China really are destined to work together. The hardest thing, if I could say, Steve, is that well disguised, but at the core, China has a profoundly zero-sum view of everything. And it's extremely difficult to negotiate with a country that looks at things in such stark black and white terms, winners, losers. Very hard to find a dynamic in which there is a true win-win solution. And I have found in my own experience, and this is literally now thousands of hours of diplomacy, how to structure diplomatic engagements that serve this larger interest of the arrival on the international stage is the very hardest thing in diplomacy in Asia. And I'll just give you one example of that. I found myself at times in a negotiation, I won't go through specifics, wanting to signal very clearly, China, you're a great power, and we need to adjust accordingly. We need to recognize your arriving role. We want you to understand that the United States sees this, right? We would take that step, and then it would almost immediately be perceived as a sign of weakness. That's the challenge. How do you negotiate with a country in a very zero-sum context in a manner that doesn't somehow reflect that this is in the context of weakness as opposed to respect?
There's a great portion of the book which kind of talks about developments in time. Sorry to focus on it. The book is about Asia, by the way, and the whole point of the pivot is our China policy needs to be embedded in our Asia policy. But because this is the National Committee on U.S.-China Relations, I'm focusing my questions on China. So there's a very interesting part of the book which talks about, you know, the transition from Hu Jintao to Xi Jinping and the consolidation of power and what that means for U.S. diplomacy vis-a-vis China. And you say direct engagement with Xi Jinping is especially important now given his increasing dominance of a decision-making process that is becoming more opaque and unpredictable. I'm reading from the book. What should we do that we're not doing? In other words, what are we not doing that we need to do more of?
Well, I mean, Steve, you know, the scarcest resource in any government is the time and attention of the senior leadership. President Obama, President Bush, before, spent quite a bit of time in high level diplomacy with Chinese interlocutors, but we have no choice but to spend even more. And in the current system, essentially, President Xi, in a very short period of time, has dismantled most of the institutions of collective leadership. And so makes most of the decisions with the advice of a very small handful of men, mostly men, in a kitchen cabinet. And most of those people have no contact with outsiders and are actually kept purposefully from interactions from people on the outside. And when they travel with him, are careful not to engage very much directly with Americans or Westerners. In that environment, the traditional institutions, the people that we interact with in the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, the State Council, the party apparatus, it's not clear that they're going to be able to carry the messages or be able to play the role that they've played in the past. I think probably you've had this experience yourself. I mean, I don't want to share a conversation we had not long ago, but we both have found ourselves occasionally in Beijing meeting with very senior people. And you get the sense that one of the reasons that they're talking to you is that they're trying to figure out what's going on in their own government. And I think that means that in the current environment, really, more...
Nobody I talk to, Kurt.
More direct engagement with Xi is going to be essential. And in those meetings, I think you have to be clear how much we indeed value the relationship, how we want to work together, but also clear about where the United States, on matters of deep national interest, are going to stand from.
I want to open the floor to questions. We've got a very distinguished audience today, so let me just ask, well, my final question and then open it to your wonderful anecdote at the end of the book. The final question is, nobody in this room argues about the need to pivot economically, diplomatically, educationally. There's nobody in this room who's going to think we have enough Americans who speak Chinese, who have enough experts in the academic community who are expert in China. We have enough diplomats in Asia. We don't. We clearly don't. We need to pivot economically because it's been since 2000 that we do more trade with Asia than we do with Europe. The strategic pivot raises the question of the costs. And what are those costs? You know, both we've got, you know, I was telling you, I don't take cars in New York, I just take the subway. And unfortunately, it doesn't work real well because we need a bunch of money to fix our subway and our trains and our bridges and our dams, you name it. And there's a cost to this. So what does the strategic pivot really cost us? You lay out some very interesting new defense systems, which we should probably put in place, but they ain't free.
Yeah, and so when people talk about the pivot, they almost always talk about military issues. And I personally believe that the leading edge of this effort, and the one that is actually the most important element, is the diplomatic and people dimension, then the curriculum dimension. And I know people are extremely anxious about the military issues, but I think we have to be careful not to underestimate how much money we've spent on our military, how powerful it is, how much we've operated in Asia. Look, it is, you know, parts of the military budget are very flexible, right? So we don't have as much for, you know, military construction for facilities that are going to be constructed in the Philippines and Australia. But I will tell you that for everything that you could point to of concern, there are other issues that you could point to that would be revealing and more hopeful. when the Sai and I work together in Southeast Asia, there isn't one country that would have said 20 years ago, yes, I want to exercise more in the United States. Every single one of them would have said, I don't want to do it, it's politically untenable. Today, virtually every country in Southeast Asia, Australia, want to interact more with the United States. And the U.S. forces are more distributed and dispersed across Asia. I think those are important and significant adjustments. If you had to ask me, what is the most, if I could do one thing, right? So I was one of those people who had never worked in the State Department, entertained all the views that...
By the way, it's a great story about him being offered the job, which is very funny.
The caricatures of the State Department. I worked at the military, the Treasury, and the White House. And so I really just didn't think much of it, to be honest. And the 4 years I served there were the best, by far and away, the best four professional years of my life. No matter what happens next, I will never have any experience like that. And I would say that I there is no place else in the government I would ever work. I would only work in State Department. I have an enormous, deep, profound regard for these people and the people I was able to serve with. And I don't have a desire to work anywhere else. If I ever had the opportunity to go back at some point, I think it would be great. But if I could do one thing, if you landed from Mars in the State Department and you looked at our budget, like the State Department budget, right? So you would think, well, clearly Europe is overwhelmingly dominant, and places like Florence and Nice are key diplomatic outposts. And in fact, you know, we have probably more diplomatic outposts in Europe than most of the rest of the world combined. Now, those are important places, but so followed by the Middle East. So Europe is number one, then the Middle East. And basically tied for third are, you know, in some form Africa and Asia. And it would always frustrate me in terms of budget discussions about trying to get more, recognizing that Asia is where the rising powers are, understanding the challenges that are involved there. What I try to do, you know, it's hard, you know, when you're a political appointee, any institution can wait you out. Any institution can just say, we'll see you later, or, you know, whatever. I tried when I was there to do a couple of things. First is to choose a handful of officers that I thought had what it took to ultimately run the department. Because ultimately, unless you run the department, unless you are making decisions about budgets, about people, then it doesn't matter. And what's fascinating about our bureau, my bureau, the State Civic Bureau, is that we've just generally been content with learning other languages, kind of little dinner parties, or little lacquer boxes, or little, you know, kind of bonsai little things, and not worry about the actual department that has been dominated by Europeanists and Middle East folks for decades. And so I tried to find those officers and look at other bureaus and try to recruit those officers, go in, spread horrible lies about the leadership of other bureaus, to try to get those people, the people underneath them, to come on over and to recognize that this is where the future lies. I believe that if we can find just a few of those people, Steve, it will make an enormous difference. Today, in our government, I have this commission book. There are dozens of senior military intelligence officers that could tell you everything that you want to know about digging a well in Helmand Province, what depth to do with that, the negotiations that would need to take place with the tribal groups, the ethnic groups. They would even know the languages, they would know the local history. Literally dozens of fine officers. Ask me how many really senior people in the U.S. government would you sit and listen to about Asia. There aren't that many. And Steve, you know that as well. And so I'm much more about investing in that next generation of leaders. So I spend a lot of time trying to talk to young Navy officers. Whenever I'm asked to talk to the incoming group of diplomats, I always try to just spread, again, four allies and other bureaus. I try to make sure that they understand learning languages, Chinese always, but also a secondary Asian language. This is where the future is. This is where we have to commit ourselves.
So Kurt starts the book with this very funny story about him being hired as assistant secretary, and he ends the book with an equally, actually a funnier story where I'm reading the book, literally laughing out loud. The question is, should we make people buy the book to read it, or do you want to tell the story now?
I'll tell it. Okay.
Then you'll think it's so good. It's really fun.
So the reason, when you read these books, like, Ashton's Presidency, Creation, Churchill, it always seems, you're always kind of head up looking, focused on some different, the distant goal, and it always seems more, heroic than at least your own life, right? And so I wanted to just describe something that happened in my own life that was true, that give you a sense of, what it's really like. And so, there's a complex relationship between the White House and the State Department. President Obama, Secretary Clinton, both, I described them in the book as kind of political velociraptors, the key hunters in the primordial jungle, and they kind of understood each other and the teams around them. So we had worked for years on something that, I still am defensive about, because I don't think it's gotten that credit with the opening to Myanmar, to Burma. So a lot of very secret diplomacy with the generals, a lot of discussions with Aung San Suu Kyi, incredibly difficult. A lot of consultations with Chinese interlocutors and with Europeans. And although, of course, there have been problems and huge challenges inside the country, but what has taken place in 5 or 6 years is remarkable, just incredible. And I'm proud to have played a small role in that. And about, at the end of 4 years, the president decided, after talking with Aung San Suu Kyi, that he would go and do kind of a progress report to underscore what had taken place in Burma, Myanmar. And so on this trip that he had taken as part of the East Asia Summit, this first one, he would go to Thailand, now deposed the leader of the democratically elected leader of Thailand, and then go from there to Myanmar. So I described what it's like. So you're kind of a State Department guy, and the president and his team graciously invite Secretary Clinton, myself, and a couple of others to go with him on Air Force One. And you're just incredibly nervous, and it's a wonderful opportunity. You got to make sure you get your clothes laid out. There's a bag drag. I spent the night before just panicked that I had somehow not packed my trousers. And so it starts all ready. I got ready downstairs. We get on the airplane. There's even a seat for me. You're just worried that there's a mistake. And in fact, there's a horrible mistake. There's no room for you on the airplane. Trust me, it all goes through your mind. You're incredibly feel awkward that everyone's looking at you, that you don't belong. So you get on the airplane, take off. I'm sitting next to my friend Jay Sullivan, who's director of policy planning. We kind of shake hands. We think to ourselves, God, this is incredible. Next thing you know, Secretary Clinton walks back. She has a great way. She always wants us to be in the room. By the way, I will just tell you guys this, honestly. I've been in a ton of institutions. I've been in a number of situations. I have never had a better boss. I've never had a more empowering person. I have the kind of personality, unfortunately, that people either like having me under them or not. And she always felt like she could trust me and that she empowered me. She had a great sense of humor, incredibly strategic, worked harder than anyone else I'd ever known. And so I'm sorry about all this email stuff. I'm sorry about how it's perceived. But I will tell you, for me, you can't take that away from me, that experience. So she came back and said, hey, come on, we're going to brief the president. And the president and his team, they're cooler than the other side of the pillow. And so you've got to try really hard not to be. I get a little excited. So I had to remind myself, got to be cool, be cool, be cool. So we walked out while I briefed. The president had kind of one leg over a chair and was very gracious to us. This is a great opening. We get guys have done is terrific. Looking forward to the visit. So I think to myself, this is great. This is going extremely well. I've got my suit, I've got my lucky tie on. Walking back to this trip, I walk back to my seat, and I thought to myself, you know, this is going to be the last time I'm on Air Force One. I got a lot of daughters at home. They love this stuff. I'm going to pick up a few things. And so this is true. And so I pick up, you know, you're supposed to pick up the menus and the little Chotsky stuff. But so I think I picked up an ashtray. And then, you know, those long flashlights, those little long things, it's kind of hammered in, but I got it out of there. So I picked up.
So all has the president should see.
All had the president should see. A ridge, I think a torch, all sorts of stuff that I stuffed. This is true.
It's in the book. Unless they get
to there, I stuffed them in my jacket. And I was at school, so I'm feeling guilty. I'm feeling bad. You know, this is wrong. This is stealing. And so I go back, I sit down in my chair. This is true. I'm literally, it's just, all I got to do is get to my vehicle, then I can pack it all up. It'll be fine. So we land, and, you know, you muster. No, I was in the last one. Yes. You go by, you know, how important you are. So it's 1 to 50. I'm in vehicle 50, which is about 2 miles from the airport. All right? So we land. I'm looking out the window. All my friends are down there. The new ambassador, Derek Mitchell, who I helped, my dear friend I've known for years. The president's asked the secretary to write that walk down the airplane. I have played a role in this. And you want to stop just for a minute, and think to yourself, this is really what it's all about. This is about service. This is about purpose. But you don't have that time, because you got to get off the back of the airplane, you got to get to your car, because if you miss the motorcade, it's over. It's over. So this is true. So I gather my stuff, I button my jacket, and I mean, it's like that. It's true. Absolutely true. I couldn't make this up. So I make my way, and I go down the back steps, and literally, and it's about 170 degrees. And so, and I can perspire in the winter. And so I start to sweat, and so I'm kind of half jogging. And I look over my shoulder, and I notice, this is a true story, that two Secret Service agents are running kind of behind me. About 20 yards back. So what did I do? Of course, you run faster, right? And so I started to run faster, and then I realized they were really coming for me. This is true. So I started doing a little bit of assert time, and I was certain they were coming to arrest me. No, seriously, taking the stuff off the airplane. And so I was thinking what the headline would look like, how horrible it would be, and I would be just like in this moment of triumph that there would be, you know, this just terrible, humiliating thing. So they're not going to get me with the stuff on me. And so I am running, throwing stuff out as we go. I'm not kidding, throwing it out with full speed, sweating head to toe. And it's hitting, and you can hear the glass breaking, all sorts of stuff. And I'm still serpentine, and so when they get to me, I'm not going to have anything on me. And so finally, they go, Dr. Campbell, Dr. Campbell. And so I stop, I'm completely out of breath. They're a little out of breath, too. And they say to me, Dr. Campbell, the president wants you right with them in the motorcade. How the And so I'm going on and on and on. And then I, as we arrive in a town, I can see out of the corner of my eye, Shuigang Temple, which is the, any of you haven't been there, it's the most beautiful imaginable thing in Asia, 100-meter gold tower. And I explain to the president, like an idiot, that no visit to Myanmar is complete without a visit to Shuigang Temple. So the president goes, why aren't we going then? And the Secret Service guy, the same guy who's been chasing me, looks at me like, what are you doing? Of course, this has been a subject of debate for weeks, and the Secret Service can't lock it down. In the end, we go, Shuigang, we have a great off the record. All the Secret Service guys have to take off their shoes. It's against tradition and requirements. We had a great visit, and it's a great trip.
It ends with these wonderful stories, but then it's just full of kind of discussions of really what U.S. Asia policy was, is, and should be. I fear the story, though, has caused us to